celebrate Ron's life. And just hearing people coming in this morning and just all the memories of Mancus and growing up and spending summers and winters here. And it's a homecoming for many of us, and it's, I was telling Mike, a homecoming for me today as well. This is the first worship service we've had of any kind here for over a year. So it just feels really good to be home. As people of faith, in our death we find resurrection. And so may this day just be a time of mourning, but also a time of celebrating new life and new possibilities. So thank you for being here today. Take time to celebrate and to mourn as well. And let us pray. The God of all creation, we gather today to celebrate the life of Ron Hopperton, a life of love and integrity, goodness, and grace. May we lift up the memories we will always have of Ron, a husband, a father, a grandfather, a brother, a friend, a trustworthy human being, and so much more. May we receive the gift of his Spirit, and may that Spirit continue to enlighten and bless our lives. And God, we give you thanks on this day for the gift of life that we have in you and the promise of resurrection. And we thank you for the beautiful life that Ron has shared with us here today. In your holy name we pray, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Shall we gather at the river where bright angel feet have trod, with its crystal tide forever flowing by the throne of God? Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. Ere we reach the shining river, lay we every burden down. Grace our spirits will deliver and provide a robe and crown. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. Soon we'll reach the shining river. Soon our pilgrimage will cease. Soon our happy hearts will quiver with the melody of peace. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. That flows by the throne of God.
Amen.
Thank you. Bonnie has picked out a verse that I'd like to read for you today from the Gospel of Matthew, the 25th chapter, verse 21. The master was full of praise, and he said, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in handling this small amount, so now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let us celebrate together." Thinking of that verse and just the assurance we want to know that we are loved, that we are cherished, that we have lived well. I also wanted to read what I would call just a companion verse or a sister verse. When eyes and he comes up out of the water and he hears that voice from heaven speaking to him. And the voice says, "You are my beloved son. With you I am well pleased." These are the words of God for the people of God, for each and every one of us here today. As we move through life and all the different things we do and accomplish and all the successes we have, I think throughout life we just want to know that we are loved, that we're cherished, that we're living well. And as human beings, we want to know that we are forgiven and that we are restored. And I think just in talking with the family, I think Ron had a very good understanding. He was a beloved child, that he lived life well. And after it's all said and done, everything we do through life, we just want to know that we are loved. And life is all about how we care for one another. And that message, or that presence of God's love and Holy Spirit moving through us and shaping us as we learn to love, to forgive, to have compassion for one another throughout life. And we are known, Ron was known by his fruit. His love, his joy, and his peace that he shared with us, his patience, kindness, and generosity, and the faithfulness that he had throughout life. I'm talking with Mike, and it's very rare to find someone who starts off in the Methodist Church, and they just are in that church throughout their life, wherever they may be. Just that faithfulness to God and to family and to his community. We are known by our fruits. And Ron shared his life through his marriage for 57 years with Bonnie. That is learning to love and falling back, stay deeper and deeper in love with one another. And to stay in that marriage and to honor one another is also to learn to forgive. To forgive our humanity, that sometimes we say the wrong thing or we get upset. But we learn to forgive, which is to learn how to love. We learn to love and forgive in all areas of our life. And Bonnie and Ron, they raised Mike and Michelle the very best that they could. Part of that fruit, part of that goodness that continues to spread throughout our communities and our world here. And all of us here today are examples, are part of the fruit of Ron's life. All of you were touched by his grace and the truth that he shared with each one of you. And so part of what we'll do today, in addition to grieving, is also just celebrating. Celebrating the fruits of his life. Celebrating those moments where we saw the living Christ within him. And we were blessed and enriched by that example that he set for us. And so I encourage you to take time not only today, but in the ensuing days and weeks, just to reflect on his life. What you learned, how you were blessed, and how that encourages us and inspires us live well. And I trust that we can hear today those words coming down from heaven. With you I am well pleased. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Amen. And at this time I would like to invite all of you, if you would like to have something like a share, a memory, just a thought. Feel free, there is room here if you want to come up and use the mic, you can. We have a small enough crowd. You can also just feel free to stand up where you are and share. So I'll open this up. Thank you.
Are you able to hear me? Ron was my childhood protector. Even when I was in a deep valley personally, he never left me. He was there. And when I was soaring on the mountain peak, Ron was there. And he was just such a caring and loving brother. This is for It's Difficult. There was a John Denver song, which reminds me so much of him. Country Roads, Take Me Home. To the place I belong, Colorado. Mountain Mama, take me home.
And I had a couple experiences with Ron over the years, and I guess the greatest one, I think Michael knows all this, but we were up below Dutton when Michael was probably 7, 8 years old, I'm not sure, I can't remember. But anyhow, we found a beautiful, Ron and I had found a beautiful, a log had fallen across the Dolores River, the West Dolores, and it was a huge pool, and we said, man, that'd be a great place to take the boys. So we had cousin Rodney and myself, and I think the little girls were even around, but I don't think they were fishing, I think they were just mostly running and playing, but Michelle and Amber, but so anyhow, we get the little guys, and they got the poles, and they're getting them out there, and boy, they're catching fish. I mean, they just, the stocking truck had probably just gone by the day before, and all these little stockers were in there, and I mean, these boys were pulling them out just as fast as they could get their line in. And the next thing we know, we see this real long bamboo pole sneaking out through there, and old Hoppy's dropping his line in. And Ron, that Hoppy was Grandpa Hop, and anyhow, he started trying to catch those fish out there because he loved to fish also. And Ronald got I've never seen a guy get as angry at his father and hollered at him and said, "Get out of there! That's for the little boys that go fish down the river, you know, leave him alone." And but it was quite a time. When we went to Kentucky, just a real quick, funny, cute story, I guess. It's probably not real cute for the church, but it's, we flew to Kentucky. Amber would have been probably about 2 years old, and so Ronnie would have been close to 6 or 7. Anyhow, we stayed with him in Kentucky. Ron and Bonnie, Ron working at DuPont, and so we get there, and Ron said, "Hey, this Saturday, my company's having this big golf tournament just for DuPont employees." He said, "But I got you in with the guy that nobody else wanted to play with." And I said, "Well, okay, I don't know, I can get this." And that never dawned on me at the point in time. So anyhow, so this guy and I, we tee off and we're playing and everybody's out there playing. And this guy started with drinking some beer. And I bet you by the end of the second hole, he'd already drank a six pack. And pretty soon, he ran out of beer. And so he said, would get up on a tee box and he'd look around. He said, "There's the cart over there. Let's hit over that direction." So rather than playing the golf holes, he was hitting the ball towards the booze cart so he could go get the booze. And by the end of the day, I was so deathly drunk that I was hugging the porcelain pot in the ladies' room because I couldn't get in the men's. And Ron finally found me and drug me home and threw me in bed, and I slept for a while and felt a little better. But anyhow, that I finally figured out why nobody wanted to.
That brother said, "Sis, I hope you have forgiveness."
That's right. When he brought me home.
You all go next, I guess. hour. And we'd walk home for lunch, you know, and Betty would have everything set out for us, just like, I grew up in a family of many girls, and Deb was, basically, I felt an only child because Ron was so much older. And of course, we looked up to Ron and everything, but anyway, then they moved, you know, to Shiprock, but then we went to college together. And I know so many stories about Hoppy. And I don't know Ron, but just one story about Hoppy when we were in college, and we could get into the games on a student ID. Well, he got Deb's student ID, I think, and to get to the game, and that he was so, he loved sports, he loved, and but anyway, so we got well acquainted down there. But then I didn't really get acquainted with Ron until a few years ago when he came back. And I had an antique store, and he came in and he wanted this organ. And it belonged to Kelly Johnson's family, actually. And he was going to have that shipped. And I was delighted. I said, nobody, you know, you just don't sell these huge organs at all. And it wasn't really, I wasn't going to make any money on it, but he was so, and he figured out how much it was going to cost to ship it, everything. But anyway, the people decided they didn't want to sell it. So, but what was really great about that is I really learned about him and his faith and his testimony. And his, you know, he gave me a little coin. Mm-hmm. And I never knew that. You know, he was such a strong Christian and lived that Christianity. And I always really, really appreciated getting to know him as I was older. You know, so, anyway. And Bonnie, I can't remember where you were from, Bonnie, but
Wisconsin.
Wisconsin.
Yes.
And I met Bonnie when they were still living over there. Thought they were such a neat couple. But anyway, that is my best memory, Ron. Yeah.
This is going to be kind of long. I hope that's okay. I did want to thank you again, from the bottom of my heart, that Mancus meant so much to my dad. And I'll go in a second, you know, all the memories that I've had here, but I did want to thank you again. If he was standing here, this would mean so much to him, to be in that, because, you know, man, in this church, that's my story. First, I'm going to say that my dad taught me. My dad taught me so many things. I'm sorry, I have this all written down, so. He taught me so many things. He taught me how to throw a football, how to throw a baseball, how to shoot baskets. And he showed me how to hammer a nail in a wooden board, how to cast a pole for catching a fish, how to ride a bike. Oil in my car, how to charge a battery, how to change a tire, but most importantly, to be responsible for my actions. And when I was fifth grade, there was this girl that I could not stand. walking home off the bus one day, and they were doing some construction next to our house, and there was some paint lying around. And I told my buddies, I said, you know what, I'm going to go grab a tree branch, dip it in paint, and paint her jeans. And they're like, what? And I said, well, we got to teach her a lesson because she's been such a bully. And I did it. And to this day, I can't believe I did it. And she looked at me like, what are you doing? And she ran home, and I walked home. And the moment I walked in the door, Dad looked at me and just shook his head. And I said, you know what I did? He said, yeah. And you know, you're going to be punished. And I said, yeah. And he said, if you knew you were going to be punished, why did you do it? And I said, Dad, she's been a bully to everybody on the bus. And I was just trying to tell her to stop. Supposed to be a funny story. And there's another time that someone dared me to throw a rock.
Over the side of the house, yes.
And I broke a window. And they looked at me and they came outside and they said, who threw the rock? And all my friends ran. And I said, and they said, it was me. And they said, why did you throw the rock at her window? And I said, because someone dared me. But I knew I was going to get punished. I knew I was going to have to pay for the window. But just part of growing up, right? Kid. But those are just two examples of things that my dad, you know, I knew I was going to need to be responsible for my actions because he raised me that way to do things that were right, to treat people right. And I did learn a lot from that growing up. Most importantly, he taught me to have a relationship with Christ, with the Lord, raised me in the church. I was, and this is interesting, so I was confirmed and baptized in the church in the sixth grade.
Yeah.
And I was always asking my friends why they waited. Because most kids were baptized when they were a baby. And I felt different. And they both told me that they wanted me to be old enough to make that decision for myself. And I didn't really understand it at the time, but that's how I was confirmed and baptized. But then later, I realized why. And so when Laura and I got married, the one thing that we talked about is the exact same thing for our kids. And so our kids did the exact same thing. You know, they grew up, got confirmed and baptized, you know, about the same age, you know. And it just started, you know, to make me realize that when you get to that point in your life where you know it's important and you want to make those decisions, you know, that it's going to mean a lot more, I think. And it really did for me because as a result of that, I would read the Bible, I would serve the church, teach Sunday school, just like my dad. My dad, so much for the church and every church that he was in. As Pastor Craig said, he grew up Methodist. But in every church he went to, and Mom can attest to this, he would always commit himself to do things for the church. You know, he served on the board of trustees, he taught, he did finances, usher. He did every single thing that he could because that was his life. He read daily devotionals. He read the Bible. You know, he did so much. And so I feel like, you know, he instilled that in me. And it just took me a while to get to that point. But he also believed that marriage is sacred. Married to my mom for 57 years. And, you know, he told me, and we've had so many conversations about that, important it is and what the Bible says about that. So just a testament to his commitment to my mom and to Christ. He gave me so much guidance about college. So I grew up or in high school, right? My I guess in my education and things, I was really gifted in math and science and physics, and chose my major when I went to the University of Texas to be a physics major. And he looked at me and said, what are you going to
But deep down, my passion was to go into medicine. I wanted to be a doctor. And I told Dad that getting a physics degree was not a big deal to me because I have no plans to use a physics degree. I just want to go to medical school. But, you know, when you go to college, things change. Your decisions change, and I've told my daughter Faith and Andrew, who's about to go to college, that whatever degree you pick, don't expect that to be your final major. In fact, even when you graduate from college, you may be doing something completely different. And that's okay, you know. So what did I do? Well, I decided not to go to medical school. And towards, I think my junior year, you know, my dad said, again, what are you going to do with physics degree? And I switched to engineering, just like my dad. So we were both chemical engineering. And it was the best thing I ever did. Thanks to him, I was able to fall back on my engineering degree and get a really good job. But I still had the passion to go to school. So I went and got my master's degree while I was working. And as soon as I got that done, then I realized, okay, school's over with, because I got it out of my system. But again, I think back to my dad's guidance, you know, that's kind of helped me today. And one thing you may not know about my dad is, believe it or not, there was a small period in his life and mine that we both worked for the same company. And it was very funny because when I started working for Occidental Chemical, there's not too many Hoppertons in the world. So as you can imagine, email just started coming around. And I would get my dad's emails. So I knew everything that my dad was working on. And then someone told me, you're not supposed to be getting his emails because there's some stuff there that's pretty confidential. And I was like, oh, sorry, you know, don't fire me. But my dad ended up retiring at 53. And I think about, I just turned 53 last month, and I think about how he was able to do that, to live 26 years retired. So he had a very good life, lived comfortably, took care of mom in all the places that they lived. And I just think that's just a testament to him, how important it was to take care of his family, you know, financially, and you know, give everyone a good life. He taught me to stay out of debt. One of the things that I learned the hard way, and I told my kids this, is be careful about getting a credit card, because it's easy to charge a credit card. But he kept telling me, you know, to not go that direction, to be very careful. And eventually I learned, to the point where I said, I'm going to be free of debt, you know, except for a mortgage on my house, you know. And that's, you know, how he conducted himself. He also taught me to contribute to a 401k for retirement. He said it's so important that you start doing that. And I can understand why, with, you know, how he was able to take care of mom and retire at such a young age. Probably the hardest thing that I ever had to do, besides this, is my dad was an alcoholic. And the first year I went to college, I had to confront him and to let him know that I loved him, but that it was something that he needed to get addressed. And he did. The one thing about my dad is when you tell him something from your heart, he follows it. And he was sober ever since that day, right? So it was hard. It was necessary. And it worked out for the best. On a lighter side, my dad loved to play golf. He golfed and golfed, and for 20, you know, a number of years he was retired, he golfed so much. I mean, Dean told a story, which is great, but I got the opportunity to play golf with my dad right around his birthday in August with two of my friends and Michelle's husband, Tom, and I had to, you know, tell people behind us not to hit into us because Dad played pretty slow. You'll get there, just please be with me if you want to play through. But the thing that I'll remember is on this par 3 hole, where they live, up in North Atlanta. He hit a shot on the green and two putted and par the hole. And he was so excited. It was great. I lived in Augusta, so I met Laura. Got to take my dad to the Masters. He loved to golf, he loved to watch it. So I was so blessed to take him to that. And then when he turned 70, the PGA Championship in Atlanta, got to take him to that, and he loved that. He loved basketball. When I was growing up in Kentucky, with Grandpa Hop, some of my favorite memories is we would go to Rupp Arena in Lexington and watch the Kentucky Wildcats play basketball over and over and over again. They had season tickets, and it was just so much fun. And my son Andrew, as you can tell from his height, is a big basketball player, played varsity 3 years at high school, and he'll be playing some more before he graduates. And he got to go to the University of Kentucky's basketball camp with John Calipari. And I took him over to Rupp Arena, and he's like, "Dad, they didn't let us into Rupp Arena." And I said, "Well, that stinks, because that's where I spent so much of my time watching games, and how can you go to a basketball camp and not be able to go to the Rupp Arena?" But the problem is, in Lexington, Rupp Arena is a multi-event place, and so it was actually closed, you know. So we had to peer in the windows, and I had to show him, you know, everywhere where I sat for games and stuff. But Dad just loved basketball. You know, he went to University of Arizona. He was a Wildcat. He followed Arizona as well with basketball. But I can't begin to tell you how much we watched it on TV, how many times he would ask me about Andrew, how many games he got to see Andrew play. And he just meant the world here. My dad had a great hook shot. We were talking about that the other day, where I was Seth and Andrew and Roderick, and they were all playing basketball at their neighborhood, and we kept watching, and he said, "I gotta get out there and play." And so he goes out on the court and does his hook shot, and fortunately he lost his balance, so he had to make sure he was okay. And, you know, my dad has so many basketball mementos, I can't even begin to tell you, and he's passed them on. He passed a lot of them on. Signed things by Adolf Rupp, and, I mean, we could go on this, but it just meant a lot to him to pass those things on. And so every time he would see Andrew, and Andrew knows this because he's like, "What is he giving me this time?" But he just loved to pass on the things that he had kept, and he keeps so much stuff, and Mom knows, boxes and boxes of things that meant a lot to him that he wanted to pass on to others. So my final words is just to let you know that, and you all know this, but he was a very strong man. Dad had Parkinson's. He had Crohn's disease. He broke his ankle fishing 4 or 5 years ago, I think with Dean, and broke his hip twice, and then he survived COVID. And I just think about all the things that he went through, you know, fighting and fighting and fighting, and even to the last day, and how strong he was, you know. It just to let you know that that was the dad that I had, that I loved. So, thanks.
As long as I'm here, I'll tell you a little bit about before Mike was born and when we were dating, and we were students of the University of Arizona, and I was a freshman, he was a junior, and I went to lunch. I had a meal ticket to the cafeteria at school, and took my tray. Later sat down, and later he told me, he said, "I was next to you, and I actually looked at your name on that meal ticket." And so he wiggled his way around and said, "Do you mind if I sit here?" And so that's starting our relationship in the with food. And so after that, he just called me all the time and we gotta go for a Coke, we gotta go here, we gotta go there. But one of the most memorable things was when Sunday came along and he said, we're going to church. And we found out we were both Methodists, so that was unusual. And we attended the Catalina Methodist Church in Tucson and went out to lunch every single Sunday. And that really impressed me. And I came from a family that honored church but not involved. And then later we were both, Ron and I, involved in church. And we were, and one thing Ron did when he, his, our last church there in Texas, he developed a prayer ministry. And we would even get emails from people in other states and everything wanting prayer. And so it really became quite an outreach to the community and to the other states. And so he was really well known for that. And as you can see, when you were looking at the casket, he had crane hands on the casket. And we also have been have that on the headstone. So this was a big, big part of his life. He was a prayer warrior, definitely a prayer warrior. And so he led me through a lot of difficult times. And he also taught me math, because I'm a fine arts major. And so we were from opposite ends. And but I learned a lot just, you know, keeping organization and different things. So I'm so glad to see our children doing that also in their lives, and our grandchildren, and his Christian life is the legacy that we want to honor.
I'm Seth. As all of y'all knew him as Ron, the grandkids knew him as Papa. And so many memories, so many just family trips and just great times together. And if there's anything that I think all the grandkids can say is Papa loved games. And it was, you know, as he'd get something, he'd say, pick a hand. And if you pick the wrong one, he'd say, the other one. And then, it was playing horse with the hoops at Uncle Mike's house or at my family's house, and just so much. And one of the memories that I got to cherish for myself was actually a fairly recent one. When Nana and Papaw first moved to Atlanta, I was able to share a few Sundays with he'd have these printouts, because I would tell him a few days before that I was going to come over and after church and just spend Sunday evening. And he would have this printout just with the devotional for the day. And I think that's just one thing I always cherish with him, is that he was, I think, easily the biggest spiritual leader I had growing up. And for all that to just trickle down through Uncle Mike, my mom, Anna, Aunt Laura, just anybody, that his faith just was deeply embedded in our blood. And it just really has just grown to show me how important faith is. And just when you don't know what's ahead, just to keep walking. And Papa, he was one of the biggest leaders. And I think we just not only saw that in his fight for just his last few months, but on top of that, just family was so much to him. And I think we can all say that if we could be half the man he was, that it'd be a great life. So, it's Papa.
Papa meant a lot to me. long as I made my free throws, he'd always he'd always make sure to tell me how great I played, even if I played bad, and it's a lot of pressure on me, but I just, he's a great role model. He taught me so much. I have a great dad, and I can tell that he raised him great, and I just want to be able to continue his legacy in the Hopperton last name in his honor. I'm just really lucky to have him as a grandpa.
It's a short word, one syllable word, but it's such a broad word about what prayer means. And for spending that time in prayer, just ask God, what did I learn? What was revealed to me through Ron, through my father, my grandfather, my brother? And just take that time and really think about those gifts that you received. And just the hope, God's hope that we may be all one. It's that love and that grace that brings us together. It just never abandons us. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. And Staff and Donna Linda's going to share that song for us.
Well, I'm not sure that I've brought to you the exact song that you really wanted, but it starts with those words that I was told. In the bulb, there is a flower. That's perfect. In the bulb there is a flower, in the seed an apple tree, in cocoons a hidden promise, butterflies will soon be free. In the cold and snow of winter, there's a spring that waits to be unrevealed until the season, something God
Sunday school, and some of you might remember Jean Bader, one of the matriarchs of our town, and how she was your little Sunday school superintendent, I bet she was pretty stern at that time. I imagine. But just the great love that she had for this area and this community and this church as well. And just really breathe in deeply that gift of God's love and how it brings us together, the gift of community and family. So let us pray here. God, we give you thanks for this day and for your faithful servant, Ron. Be with his family